So last time we start discussion on aortic stenosis. Aortic stenosis is nothing but narrowing of the aortic wall opening. It's narrowing of the aortic wall opening resulting in obstruction to the blood flow from the ventricle to the ascending aorta within system. Etiology of aortic stenosis in infants, in children, and in adolescents, most commonly congenital aortic stenosis. Either it is subvolumular or supravolumular aortic stenosis. Then in young adults to middle age, means up to 40 years of age, there are two causes of aortic stenosis. One, in young adult, rheumatic heart disease. Though rheumatic heart disease causing aortic stenosis is a rare condition, but in young adults, we can suspect rheumatic heart disease as a cause of aortic stenosis. And second is calcification and fibrosis in a congenitally bicuspid wall. Congenitally bicuspid wall means having two leaflets. So, if any person having congenitally bicuspid aortic wall, this aortic wall is more prone for fibrosis and calcification at the age of 40. At the age of 40, and that results in aortic. In elderly, because of degenerative changes and because of calcification. Pathophysiology. As we know, there is obstruction to the flow of blood. We should understand the hemodynamics in any compound heart disease, whether it is stenosis or it is regurgitation. So you should be able to understand the changes in hemodynamics and their effects on your heart and on your body. So it is not very difficult to understand if you know properly the cardiac cycle and the circulation. So there is obstruction to the flow of blood from ventricle to aorta. That means there is increase in blood volume in the left ventricle. Increased blood volume in the left ventricle causes increased intraventricular pressure. If there is increased intraventricular pressure and increased blood volume in the left ventricle, that results in hypertrophy of left ventricle in order to accommodate that increased blood volume and in order to compensate this increased pressure. So there occurs left ventricular hypertrophy. If there is left ventricular hypertrophy, that means the oxygen demand of the myocardium, because there is increasing muscle mass. There is increasing muscle mass. Hypertrophy means increasing muscle mass. So if there is increasing muscle mass, that means it results in increased oxygen demand of your heart. And if this increased oxygen demand by the heart is not fulfilled by the coronaries, if it is not fulfilled by coronaries, then it will result in ischemia of the cardiac tissue. Results in ischemia of the cardiac tissue, is damage to the cardiac. So initially there is hypertrophy, later on there is dilatation of the chamber, and later on because of ischemia your heart fails. So heart become weak and there will occur heart failure. So it is mainly left sided heart failure. In mitral regurgitation, in aortic stenosis, in aortic regurgitation, it is mainly left sided heart failure. In mitral stenosis, it is predominantly right sided heart failure. In case of pulmonary stenosis, in case of tricuspid stenosis, in case of mitral stenosis, it is mainly a right-sided heart failure. But in case of mitral regurgitation, in case of aortic regurgitation, in case of aortic stenosis, it is mainly or it is commonly predominantly damaging to the left side of the heart. So it is left-sided heart failure. So ultimately your heart fails or there occurs heart failure. And then symptoms of heart failure. Symptoms of heart failure most commonly breathlessness. So, increased filling pressure, ventricular dilatation, then there occurs dysfunction of the left ventricle because of ischemia and it results in heart failure. There are cardinal symptoms of aortic stenosis. One, angina, breathlessness, syncope. These three are cardinal symptoms. Angina, breathlessness, and syncope. These three characterize aortic stenosis. Usually when aortic stenosis is mild to moderate, then patient is asymptomatic. Patient is able to compensate. Or your heart has adaptation. So in mild to moderate aortic stenosis, patient usually remains asymptomatic. And patient becomes symptomatic once your aortic stenosis becomes severe. So angina, breathlessness, syncope. These are the three cardinal symptoms of aortic stenosis. External dyspnea, angina, syncope, and sudden death is very, very common in aortic stenosis. Sudden death is very, very common. Then, episodes of acute pulmonary edema because of acute left-sided heart failure. Acute left-sided heart failure results in acute pulmonary edema. So, episodes of acute pulmonary edema sudden death, very common. And the cardinal symptoms are angina, breathlessness, and syncope. This angina is mainly because of increased oxygen demand by the heart, which is not fulfilled by the coronary. Because if stroke volume is less, if cardiac output is less, there is obstruction to the flow of blood from the ventricle to ulna. That means it will affect your stroke volume and cardiac output. There is less stroke volume, there is less cardiac output. If stroke volume and cardiac output is less, that means there is problem with the blood flow in coronaries also. There is problem with the blood flow in coronaries also. The blood flow in coronaries is also not good. As well as there is increased oxygen demand by the heart. So it cannot be fulfilled by the coronaries. It results in ischemia of the cardiac tissue, and this ischemia of cardiac tissue results in anginal pain. Anginal pain means chest pain. Angina is nothing but chest pain because of cardiac tissue ischemia. Angina is the symptom of ischemic heart disease. It is a symptom of ischemic heart disease. It is nothing but a chest pain because of heart problem, or because of ischemia of the cardiac tissue. That is for angina. Breathlessness. Breathlessness is mainly because of heart failure, because of coronary congestion. And this syncope. This syncope is mainly because of there is decreased blood supply to your brain. There is decreased stroke volume, there is decreased cardiac output. So it results in decreased blood supply to your brain. If blood supply to brain is decreased, it results in syncope, means giddiness. Patient usually complaining of syncope. Initially, this syncope, breathlessness, these are mainly of exertion. Means exertional breathlessness, exertional syncope. When patient exercises, when patient is running, when patient is climbing stairs, because whenever patient is exercising, when your patient is exercising or doing some strenuous physical activity. So that results in increased blood flow to your muscles, because muscles require more blood. During exertion, during exercise, your muscles require more blood. So the blood is shifted to muscles. So already your stroke volume and cardiac output is compromised in aortic stenosis. There is less cardiac output and less stroke volume, and your muscles are requiring now more and more blood. So this blood is shifted to muscles, so that your brain get again less blood supply. So your body is not able to increase the cardiac output. Your heart is not able to increase cardiac output to increase the stroke volume during increased demand. In exercise and physical exertion, there is increased demand by the body. That it tells your heart to increase cardiac output to increase stroke volume, but your heart is not able to increase stroke volume and cardiac output during increased demand. So your brain gets less blood supply during exercise, during physical exertion, and patient complaining of syncope. So syncope and breathlessness, initial stages is mainly on physical exertion. So it is exertional dyspnea or exertional syncope, because there is a fixed cardiac output, there is a fixed stroke volume in aortic stenosis. So heart is not able to increase it according to demand. So patient complaining of angina, breathlessness, syncope, initially on exertion and then later on in severe critical aortic stenosis at rest. These are the symptoms. Signs: general examination, cardiovascular system examination. On general examination, as there is less cardiac output and less stroke volume, that means your pulse volume should be also less, because the volume of pulse depends on your stroke volume. If stroke volume is less, pulse volume is also less. If stroke volume is more, pulse is also a good volume. Volume of pulse is nothing but is the amplitude of your pulse, which depends on your systolic blood pressure. Systolic blood pressure depends on your stroke volume. So there is low volume pulse, blood pressure can be normal, can be low, or it can be high in old age because of atherosclerotic changes in the blood vessels. Respiratory rate increase if patient is breathless, at rest. If patient in heart failure, you get increased jugular venous pressure and edema over the lower limb if patient in heart failure. Then cardiovascular system examination, in inspection, palpation, auscultation. In inspection, you have to see the position of exit pulse. No doubt it is shifted outward, because just like in mitral regurgitation, here is also left ventricular hypertrophy, left ventricular dilatation. So your apex impulse is shifted downward and towards the axilla, outward and downward is towards the axilla. Then in palpation, you have to confirm the position of apex impulse. You have to see the presence of fill. There is presence of thrill, palpable thrill on palpation in severe aortostenosis. Then in auscultation, you have to auscultate the heart sounds and you have to see whether murmur is present or not. Means any rumbling heart sound present or not. So, yes, no, yes, no. And if patient with heart failure, you get Gallop rhythm. Gallop rhythm means additional S3 or S4. That is called Gallop rhythm, which is a sign of heart failure and the presence of murmur. And the murmur is systolic murmur because turbulence to the blood flow occurs when blood goes from ventricle to aorta. That means during ventricular systole, when your ventricle contracts, the blood has to go from ventricle to aorta. If there is narrowing of the lumen, that produces the turbulence in the flow of blood. That means there is systolic murmur. Turbulence is responsible for production of murmur. That means in aortic stenosis, you get systolic murmur. In mitral regurgitation, you get systolic murmur. In mitral stenosis, you get diastolic murmur. In aortic regurgitation, you get diastolic murmur. So you should be able to understand the mechanism of murmur, how it is systolic and how it is diastolic, and why it is produced. Now the respiratory system, as we know, crepitations at the basis of blood because of pulmonary congestion and pulmonary edema. So heart failure, pulmonary congestion, pulmonary edema is very common, and that results in crepitations at the basis of blood. Crepitations are produced because there is fluid in interstitial spaces of the lung and there is fluid in the alveoli. So that produces when air passes through such moist environment. Air has to pass from such moist environment. There is fluid in alveoli, there is fluid in interstitial spaces. So that results in crepitations. So cardiovascular system examination, respiratory system examination, and general examination. Investigations, any cardiac patient or any cardiovascular disease require these three basic investigations, X-ray, ECG, and 2D. On X-ray, you get cardiomegaly if there is left ventricular hypertrophy and dilatation. On X-ray, that is the positive finding, that is cardiomegaly, enlargement of the heart, the ECG, and the 2D echo. 2D echo, you can visualize the aortic wall, the narrowing of aortic wall, how much is the area, whether there is calcification or not, whether it is supramedullary cellular, everything. You can see on 2D echo and for the doctor. So that is diagnostic, X-ray, ECG, and 2D. Treatment, as we know, medical management in vulvar heart disease has a limited role. In any vulvar heart disease, medical management has a limited role. Surgical correction is the only definitive role. Surgical correction of any vulvar defect, either it is stenosis or either it is regurgitation. But surgical correction is the definitive role. Medical management is related only to manage the patient symptomatically or to manage the complications. Either to manage the complication or to manage patient symptomatically. But it has limited role. It is not definitive treatment or it is not a permanent treatment. Permanent treatment is surgical correction. So medical management include if patient complaining of chest pain, angina because of issue of the heart tissue, then you have to give anti-anginal drug. Anti-anginal drug like nitrates, like sorbitrate, isosorbate, mononitrate or dinitrate. So nitrates are anti-anginal drugs. Then again, these patients are more prone for cardiac arrhythmia. So if patient heart rate is increased, patient in arrhythmia, rhythm is not regular, patient is either in atrial fibrillation, flutter or ventricular, anything. If patient's heart rate is increased, rhythm is not regular, you have to do beta blockers. So beta blockers for arrhythmia. Either calcium channel blocker or beta blocker to control the heart rate. Nitrates for angina, beta blocker, calcium channel blocker for arrhythmia. Then diuretics for heart failure. If patient in heart failure, if there is pulmonary congestion, if there is pulmonary edema, if there is spinning over the lower lip. So to remove this excess of fluid, you have to give diuretics, furosemide or spironolactone. The definitive treatment is always surgical. You have to do either balloon valvotomy, means you have to dilate the opening of the aortic wall. Just we see in mitral stenosis, balloon mitral valvotomy, just like that. Aortic balloon valvotomy means you have to dilate the opening of the aortic wall. Or if it is calcified, then you cannot dilate with the balloon. You cannot do balloon valvotomy if the wall is calcified. So at that time, you have to do aortic wall replacement. So surgical management include either aortic wall replacement or balloon valvotomy. So this completes your rheumatic fever, rheumatic heart disease with vulvar heart diseases. So it is the end of vulvar heart disease and rheumatic heart disease. So rheumatic fever, rheumatic heart diseases, and vulvar heart disease. So completed this topic from cardiovascular system. Now we proceed for ischemic heart disease. The important topic. Ischemic heart disease. What is myocardial infarction? So, ischemic heart disease, it is a broad term. Ischemic heart disease, as the name suggests, means it is ischemia of the heart tissue. The ischemia of any tissue means there is decreased blood supply to the tissue of the body that will result in damage to the tissue and that will impair the functional ability of the tissue. If there occurs decreased blood supply to the tissue, decreased oxygen supply, decreased nutrient supply to any tissue of the body, it becomes your body tissue and it will result in impairment or it is the functional impairment of the tissue. So ischemic heart disease means it is ischemia of the cardiac tissue. Ischemia of the cardiac tissue, if there is ischemia of the cardiac tissue, means decreased blood supply to your cardiac tissue, particularly the myocardium. If there is less blood supply, it will damage myocardium and it will weaken your heart. Damage will result in weakening your heart. The functional ability of the heart decreases. Functional ability of heart decreases. That is ischemic heart disease. This ischemic heart disease is also known as coronary artery disease. It is also known as coronary artery disease because ischemia to cardiac tissue occur if your coronary arteries are not in good condition or there is any problem with your coronary arteries. Because the blood supply of heart is coronary arteries. Left coronary artery, right coronary artery. So coronaries, they mainly supply your heart. So if there is problem with coronary arteries, branches of coronary arteries, then that results in decreased blood supply to the heart. And decreased blood supply to the heart results in ischemia of the heart. It is also known as coronary artery disease. Ischemic heart disease is a condition in which there is inadequate supply of blood and oxygen to the portion of myocardium. So there is imbalance between oxygen supply and demand also. So ischemia occurs because of inadequate supply, plus ischemia occurs if the demand is increased. As we discussed in vulvar heart disease, if there is hypertrophy, demand is increased. If there is hypertrophy, demand is increased, but this demand is not fulfilled by the normal coronaries, or the normal coronaries are not able to fulfill the increased demand, then at that time also results in ischemia of the tissue. That also results in ischemia of the tissue. So even though your coronary arteries are normal, but the demand is increased, this increased demand, the coronaries are not able to fulfill, then that also results in ischemia of the cardiac tissue. So either it is inadequate supply of the blood because of diseases of coronary artery, or the imbalance between oxygen supply and demand. It's increased demand, but supply is not as compared to demand. So that also results in ischemia of heart. So ischemic heart disease is either inadequate supply of blood or imbalance between supply and demand. And it is mainly caused by coronary artery diseases. So mainly it is caused by atherosclerosis of the coronary artery. So it is mainly caused by atherosclerosis of coronary artery. So ischemic heart disease presented in three ways. Patient of ischemic heart disease presented in three ways. One is angina, means chest pain. One is angina, patient usually presented with chest pain. Second, acute myocardial infarction, means heart attack. Patient directly reach hospital or admit in hospital with acute myocardial infarction, means a heart attack. And third, patient directly presented with heart failure or any type of arrhythmia, or dilated cardiomyopathy. It is also called as ischemic dilated cardiomyopathy. So ischemic heart disease presented clinically in three ways: in the form of angina, in the form of acute myocardial infarction, and in the form of dilated ischemic cardiomyopathy. Dilated ischemic cardiomyopathy, patient can present either in heart failure or in any type of arrhythmia. So that is the presentation of ischemic heart disease. Most common presentation is anginal pain, that is chest pain, and second, acute mitral infarction. But many patients never admitted to hospital with history of chest pain or with history of acute mitral infarction, and they directly presented in hospital with heart failure, directly presented in any type of cardiac arrhythmia, or directly presented with dilated cardiomyopathy. So these are the three ways. So the most common way is angina and acute myocardial infarction. So the most common cause of coronary artery disease or blockage of coronary arteries, atherosclerotic process. This atherosclerotic process results in narrowing of the coronary artery or blockage of the coronary arteries or one of the branch of coronary artery. So atherosclerosis can affect any artery in the body. If it affects the blood vessels of the heart, that means coronaries, it results in angina, acute myocardial infarction, or sometimes sudden death, sudden cardiac death. If it involves your blood vessels of brain, if atherosclerosis involves blood vessels of brain, or if the blood vessels of brain are narrow because of atherosclerosis, there is decreased blood supply to the brain, it results in stroke, cerebrovascular accident. This patient presented with attacks of paralysis. Or loss of speech, anything. Then if the blood vessels of limbs are affected, particularly the lower limb, blood vessels of limbs are affected, if there is atherosclerosis in the blood vessels of lower limb, it results in claudication. Claudication means leg cramps. Patient usually complaining of severe calf muscle pain on walking. Severe pain in the lower limb on walking. That is called claudication. This claudication is nothing but it is the pain because of ischemia. So that is about the atherosclerosis, and this is a process which is age related. This atherosclerosis is the process which is an age related process. See how the atherosclerosis affects the lumen of the coronaries. See, this is the lumen. It is a blood vessel. Blood vessel having media, adventitia, and intima. Blood vessel having intima part, media part, and adventitia part. And this is the lumen of blood vessel. So in atherosclerosis, see, this is the atherosclerotic plaque. This is atherosclerotic plaque, but the lumen is not so compromised. The lumen is not so compromised because of atherosclerosis. So it will result in stable angina. Stable angina means patient complaining of chest pain only on physical exertion when demand is increased. Patient complaining of chest pain on exertion when demand is increased. That is stable angina. See, this atherosclerotic process go on increasing. It go on increasing. Now there is subtotal occlusion. There is formation of thrombus. And the lumen is again narrow. As compared to this lumen is again narrowed because of increased atherosclerotic process because of thrombus. So it compromises the lumen of blood vessel, means it compromises the blood supply. So it will result now in unstable angina, means angina at rest. That much is the problem. Then it results in angina at rest. Patient complaining of chest pain even at rest, that is called unstable angina. It is subtotal occlusion. Very narrow lumen is happening, means very less blood supply to your heart. Now see here, there is complete occlusion of the blood vessel because of thrombus, because of atherosclerotic process. There is complete occlusion of the blood vessel. If there is complete occlusion, it results in necrosis of tissue. Now it is not just ischemia. If there is complete stoppage of blood vessel, blood supply to any tissue, if blood supply to any tissue is totally stopped, complete stoppage, then it results in necrosis of the tissue. And this necrosis of tissue or necrosis of the cardiac tissue, that means it is acute myocardial infarction or heart attack. That is called as heart attack, acute myocardial infarction. If blood supply is totally blocked, there is necrosis of cardiac tissue or necrosis of the myocardium, then it results in acute myocardial infarction. Understand? This is the blood vessel, this is the lumen, this is the atherosclerotic process, formation of thrombus. So stable angina, unstable angina, and acute myocardial infarction. Depending on how much the coronaries are affected or to what degree coronaries are affected. your daily hormones are affected, and how much is the blockage. See the blood supply to your heart. Coronaries are nothing but branches of aorta. So there are two main coronaries, right coronary, left coronary. Then branches of right coronary and branches of left coronary. These are the mainly branches of left coronary. Left circumflex, left anterior descending. So it mainly supplying your left side heart, left ventricle. See, this is the right coronary. It mainly supplying right ventricle and posterior part of the heart and inferior part. Right coronary artery mainly supply right ventricle, inferior part of heart and posterior part. And this is left coronary mainly supply left sided heart. So coronaries is the main blood supply of your heart. Now, what are the risk factors of ischemic heart disease? Who are the people at risk of this ischemic heart disease? Mostly age. We know atherosclerosis is an age-related process. As the age advances, atherosclerotic process will damage your blood vessels. So, advanced age. Then obesity. In obesity, because of cholesterol, because of increased lipid level, atherosclerotic process is fast if your cholesterol is high, if lipid level in your body is high. This process of atherosclerosis to be very fast. So obesity is the risk factor because of the increased cholesterol level and increased level, which will damage your blood vessels or block your blood vessels in early age. So advanced age, obesity, male sex. Ischemic heart disease is commonly males as compared to females. In females, ischemic heart disease is more common after menopause. So estrogen is always protective to female. Estrogen is always protective for female against ischemic heart disease. So ischemic heart disease in females is more common after menopause. In male sex or males, ischemic heart disease is more common in male. So age, obesity, male sex. Then addictions like smoking, alcohol, tobacco chewing. Again, these are the risk factors. Smoking is a very, very, very great risk factor for coronary heart disease. Is very, very dangerous. Alcohol and smoking and tobacco chewing. Nicotine is very dangerous to heart. It will result in heart attack at early age or sudden cardiac death. So, people who smoke, there is always a history of sudden cardiac death because of coronary artery disease. So smokers usually having sudden cardiac death. Alcoholic patients also having sudden cardiac death. So addictions, these are the risk factors. Then hypertension, diabetes, these are also the risk factors for ischemic heart disease. Then high cholesterol level, stress and physical inactivity, sedentary lifestyle or physical inactivity. These are the risk factors of ischemic heart disease. Age, obesity, male sex, addiction, hypertension, diabetes, high cholesterol, stress and physical inactivity. Now, the presentation of ischemic heart disease in three ways. One is in the form of angina, in the form of acute myocardial infarction. These two are important for you to understand what is angina and to understand what is acute myocardial infarction or what is heart attack. And third presentation is directed cardiomyopathy or heart failure, which we'll discuss later on. But there is a separate topic of heart failure. So angina is nothing but it is a pain which occurs. Because of ischemia of the cardiac tissue. So chest pain resulting from angina is nothing but the chest pain because of ischemia of the cardiac tissue or decreased blood supply to the cardiac tissue because of coronary artery disease. So angina is a symptom of ischemic heart disease. Or it is a chest pain because of ischemic heart disease. See, this chest pain because of ischemic heart disease or angina pain is very difficult. you should able to recognize or to differentiate between chest pain because of heart problem or chest pain because of other problems. So you should be able to differentiate. You should be able to identify anxiety. When your patient presented to you or comes to you in OPD with complaint of chest pain, your aim is first to rule out whether it is anxiety pain or not, because which is more dangerous. Any patient when complaining of chest pain, your aim is to first exclude whether this pain is because of angina or not. Means your aim is first exclude angina pain and then decide about other causes of chest pain if it is not angina. If you confirm that it is not angina, then you exclude other causes or you think over other causes of chest pain. So your aim is whether patient is young or old age or middle age. But your aim is first to exclude whether this pain is angina or not. So just